All right, welcome back to thecloudchurch.org. I'm Robert Breaker, missionary evangelist to Spanish and English speaking people. And we've been going verse by verse through the epistles of Paul, and we are now in Galatians. So we finished 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, and now we're in Galatians. And I went up and left this up from the last teaching that we just did, as we got from verse 10 down to about verse 12 or 13. So we're going to start at verse 13 this time. Sorry, I got something in my eye. A lot of these dry erase markers can get very dry and get in your eye. so we're back to Galatians, and in verse 13, we'll begin there. So Galatians 1:13, it says, "For you have heard of my conversation." Now conversation, he's not talking about the things that he talked about. The word conversation in the Bible quite often means your manner of living or your way of living. So that's something in Old English. Words change a lot of times. And the word conversation in the Bible doesn't always mean like someone talking to someone back and forth. Their conversation means their way of living. There's a reference in 1 Peter chapter 3. And there's actually a lot of references, but just look at one as an example. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 1. "Likewise, you wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives." What does that mean? It means by the way they live. So the conversation isn't just the speaking. It's by showing by your conversation, your way of living, how you are. So he says, "You have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that," and then he tells you. So this shows you from the context in Galatians 1:13 that conversation here means manner of life or way of living. So he says, "For you have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it." So Paul did some horrible, horrible things. Paul did a lot of bad to the early church, and he killed a lot of people. And he says he persecuted the church of God and wasted it. And we looked a little bit about the church last time and who the church is and who's in it, how it's made up of Jew and Gentiles. And Gentiles are fellow heirs of the same body. And he says, in the Jews' religion. I want to look at that for a second. What is religion? Well, the interesting thing about this is that this passage of scripture here, the context, tells us what religion is, or what it does, excuse me. What is religion? Religion is a system of works that people do to try to justify themselves before God. And religion is nothing but works. That's religion. Religion is works. I'll just put it like that. Now look at the difference. We looked at this last time. This is the work of Jesus. And the work of Jesus, the gospel, teaches us we can be saved by grace through faith without works. So there is a difference between saved by works and being saved by faith. Now, of course, I hope by now you've memorized Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works." So we're saved by grace through faith without works. But religion teaches no, salvation is by works. So are we religious? Do we believe in religion? No. I'm not a religious person. I don't call myself religious. I call myself saved. So there is a difference between religion and salvation. Salvation is what a man takes when he realizes he can't save himself. So salvation is believing. And it's basically rejecting your works. So salvation is when you reject your own works and you trust solely and completely upon the finished work of Jesus Christ. Who killed Jesus? The religious crowd. Now, what is religion? That's what religion is. It's telling people, do these certain things to be saved. And boy, they have a lot of them. Be baptized. Speak in tongues. Do this. Don't do that. You have to go to Mass, you have to take this, you have to drink that, you have to wear this holy underwear in the case of the Mormons, or you have to do this, you have all these things, you have to be baptized in water. It's you have to do such and such according to religion. And in salvation, it's you don't do anything but simply rest and trust upon what Jesus Christ has done for you. Now, doesn't that sound funny? The first thing a sinner thinks when he realizes he's a sinner is, oh, now what do I got to do to make things right? I mean, that's in man to think, I got to do something for God to accept me. And yet God says, don't do anything because I've already done it. Now just come to me. It's almost against the nature of man. That's why Paul says that the gospel which I was preached of me is not after man. It's not something that Paul made up, because had Paul made up this gospel, he would have, like all religions, made it into a gospel of, okay, here's what you got to do to get saved, and he would have given you a list of works. So this is obviously God's gospel, and it's not of works. It's grace through faith without works. So we see what religion is, but what does religion do? Well, according to this verse, this chapter here, we find out what religion does. Religion persecutes. And you can't look at the history of the world without seeing religions persecuting other people. It profits, because religion is all about, like one man said, religion is a racket. And it also preaches tradition. And we find this in this passage of Scripture. Religion persecutes, verse 13. It profits, verse 14. In verse 15, is it? Or also verse 14? 14. Let's look at that. Religion persecutes, verse 13. For you've heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. So what does religion do? Well, what religion does, it puffs people up with self-righteousness and pride. If you're a religious person, you've been instructed your whole life, you've got to be good and you've got to do certain things. And the more you do, the more righteous and the more God will accept you. So the more you try to follow your religion and do what your religion tells you, the more prideful you become. And the more you think, look how great I am. I am so wonderful because look at all the great things I've done. And it makes you so prideful that when someone comes to you and says, hey, here's the real gospel, you're a liar. You're not right. You're a sinner. Who do you think you are? And immediately a person, because they're so full of pride and self-righteousness, they attack others because they feel like they're attacking them. That's religion. It makes people angry and upset and hateful and just want to kill other people who don't agree with them. Because if they're wrong, they know deep down they're going to hell. So they can't be wrong. So they've just deceived themselves into thinking, I'm right and nobody else is right. And I'm the only one who's right. So don't you come with me and tell me something different. Because if you're right, I can't even think if you're right, because I'll go to hell. So religion makes people into just mean, hateful individuals who don't want to hear anything else. And it also makes them this, intolerant. The most intolerant people in the world are religious people. You know who else is intolerant? People who claim to be atheists, which is hilarious, because atheists don't believe in God. So you go, oh, yeah, well, I believe in God because God did this and God did, and they get so upset. Well, atheism really is a religion, because in an atheist, they make themselves their own God. You know who else is intolerant? Liberals. Liberals are intolerant. The homosexual crowd is very intolerant. They all pride themselves upon being how tolerant they are, but yet they're the most intolerant people in the world. Because when you make up in your mind that you're right and everybody else is wrong, you'll always think you're better than someone else. And when someone comes and tries to convince you otherwise, you immediately get in the flesh, get angry, and want to persecute that person. So religion is horrible. Religion is awful. Well, let me erase this. I'll make more room up here. But what does religion do? It persecutes. But religion also does this. Look at verse 14. And profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. What does it do? It profits. Religion tells people, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do this to get saved. But you know what religion does? It goes, now, if you want to do those things, you got to pay me for it. Let's take the Roman religion for an example. The Roman religion tells you that they're the only church. And unless you go to their church, you're not right with God. And to go to their church, you've got to pay for the Mass. And you've got to pay for candles to light the candles. The old saying for paying for the Mass is, high Mass, high money. Low Mass, low money. They'll put on a show for you the more you pay. And you got to pay for this, and you got to pay for that, and pay for confirmation. And it's all about this right here. And then they went so far as to teach in the Middle Ages indulgences. And indulgences said, well, if you will pay us for a certain sin that you'd like to do, we'll write out a piece of paper that you're forgiven of this sin before you even do it. Do you see how religion is a racket and it's all about money? They went so far as to say, well, your loved one dies, he doesn't go to heaven or hell, he goes to purgatory. And the only way to get him out of purgatory is to pay us money. And the more you pay us, the faster he'll get out of purgatory. Religion's a racket. It's all about making money. That's why I say I'm not religious. I am saved. I don't want religion. I don't want to put people under a system in which they have to pay me so that I get richer than them. That's what religion is about. It's persecuting people. It's profiting off of people. But then look at this. He says in verse 14, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. It preaches tradition. In other words, religion makes tradition more important than the Bible. So as long as it's been something that they've done for years, then it must be true because they've done it for years, even though it's wrong. And that's the problem with religion. It's powerful. It makes people think, yeah, you're righteous when you're not. And it appeases people's conscience by saying, oh, you want to do wrong? Well, just pay me some money for it and I'll forgive you. And that appeases their conscience. I'll tell you a story real quick about religion. In Honduras, where I was as a missionary, there was a brother there that was, he was awesome. He said before he got saved, he used to go to the Catholic Church. And he said, this is how Catholics think. I said, okay, tell me the story. He said, I was about 12 and I went to my first confirmation or whatever it was that they do. And he said that he had all the candles and everybody did all this thing and they were all looking at him. He said the day was all about him and he was just so happy. This is such a great day. And then he said he went outside, his mom's standing next to him, and all the people are shaking his hand, leaving the church. And then after everybody went by, across the street was one of his friends, a little 12-year-old. And he picked up a rock about that big around, and he threw that rock as hard as he could at this young man who had just had his confirmation. And my friend, he told me, he said, that rock hit me in the belly so hard. He said, I just hunked over like this, and I had the worst pain. It knocked the wind out of me and everything. He said, I could not believe that my best friend would pick up a rock and throw it and hit me in the belly on my greatest day of my life, my confirmation day in the Catholic Church. He said, I went up to my friend after I got my wind back and I said, why did you do that? He said, my friend just laughed. He goes, oh, I'll just go and confess it next week and I'll have that sin forgiven. And he said, right there is when he realized there's something very wrong with religion. Because religion allows you to do whatever you want and then say, oh, well, I'll just go to the religion and have it forgiven. And that's how a lot of religious people are. They're vile. They're wicked. They're evil. Because whatever evil they do, they think, well, even though I'm doing evil, I can always pay for that. And if I give money or if I can and get the tradition to allow me to do something wrong and get forgiveness for it, I will. You know, most of the mafia is Catholics. Because Catholicism allows a credit system for sin. You see, you go sin and do whatever you want, but as long as you come to Mass on Sunday, then it's forgiven. So all week long you can live like hell and then get it forgiven that week. That's not how it works. That's not grace. That's religion. And religion preaches tradition. So the problem with religion is religion doesn't save. Matter of fact, it was the religious crowd that killed Jesus Christ. So do you want religion or salvation? That's the problem. Well, religion is works, and religion is works that enrich those that are ahead of the religious crowd. But salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast. And it's true riches. We get spiritual riches in high places through Jesus Christ. So you need to know the difference between religion and salvation. Religion is never, ever referred to as salvation in the Bible. Let's look at Acts 26:5. Look at a couple verses about religion in the Bible. Acts 26:5. And I'm hoping we can finish this chapter today of Galatians chapter 1, so we'll try. Acts 26 and verse 5. And Paul is giving his testimony here, his defense before Herod Agrippa, but also a testimony. And he says, let's look at verse 4. My manner of life from my youth, which was at the first among mine own nation at Jerusalem, know all the Jews, which knew me from the beginning, if they would testify that after the most straitest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. What did he call it? He called it a sect. Today, That word is almost a bad word. Because religious sects exist all throughout the world, and most of them are so outrageous that people look at that and say, man, that's a cult. And that's another word that is arise to describe sects or religions or cults. Because quite often, cults teach certain things that a person has to do that are so outrageous, a sane person goes, huh? How do you, huh? So, religion is not salvation. And sects and cults, I'm thinking, the reason I was laughing and it's really not funny was that guy, I think his name was Jim Jones or something like that, and how he took all those crowd down to French Guyana or wherever it was and then had them drink the Kool-Aid. If you can deceive people into thinking that you're right and religion is only through you, and you can deceive people into following you, you can get them to do anything. And that's what that sect, that false cult that Paul was in, allowed. Because Paul was in that sect thinking, we are the only ones with the truth, and he got permission to go persecute and kill the early Christians. So not only does religion prosecute, it kills. There's a great big religion in the world today called Islam. And it's all over the news. The attack on Paris and all these. Most of your attacks of murder today are through Islam, because the religion of Islam teaches kill anybody that doesn't believe what that religion believes. So religion is not only big and gigantic in the world, but it's dangerous. I think of the Spanish Inquisition. What happened in the Spanish Inquisition? They persecuted the people that weren't following the Catholic Church. They took everything that they owned and profited off of it. And they've claimed, well, it's just tradition, that's why we're doing it. So watch out for religion. Religion is an awful thing. So back to Galatians chapter 1, verse 13. For you heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. Well, there's another verse in James chapter 1 that tells us what religion is. James chapter 1, verse 26. And hopefully we can get away from this verse into something else. But the Bible tells us what religion is. And it's exactly what I told you. It's works. Religion is, in James chapter 1, verse 26. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. And what does religion allow? Religion allows people to become deceived into thinking they're doing something right when they're doing wrong. Is it right to kill people? No, but if you become religious, you become deceived in your own heart into thinking, whatever I do, as long as it's for my religion, it's good. So if I kill, then that must be right, because they're wrong. So it puffs people up with pride and deception. But verse 27 says, pure religion undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. So James tells us what pure religion is. It's doing good to others and keeping yourself from the world. So true religion is pure works. And if there was a good religion in the world, that'd be great, and which teaches people to only do good. But the problem is, all religion deceives people and fills people with pride. The Bible says that Leviathan, which we know is Satan in the book of Job, is the king of all the children of pride. So religion pretty much is Satan's teaching, but salvation is God's teaching. Salvation is through the gospel. So back to Galatians chapter 1 and verse 14. And Paul says, and profited in the Jews' religion above many of my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of the fathers. Now look at verse 5. But when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace. Now wait a minute. Paul told us something last time. He said that God revealed unto him the gospel and taught it unto him, verse 11 and 12. And yet here in verse 15, God tells us that it pleased God to separate Paul unto himself from the womb. So here's Jesus Christ, and we looked at the church age last time. Here's the church age, and then over here we have the rapture, and then the tribulation is this 7-year period, and then we have Jesus returning at the Battle of Armageddon, and over here is the 1,000-year millennial reign of Jesus Christ. So, the church age, we saw, it started out to the Jews, and we saw Christ is here. We saw the early apostles preaching. What were they preaching? The emphasis was on preaching on believing in the name of Jesus, on who he was, and the emphasis was on water baptism. And it was all to Israel. And about that water baptism, by the way, here's John over here. And John came preaching water baptism. And who was he preaching to? To Jews, to Israel. So then you have over here a little later, up shows Paul. And God started using Paul to give the gospel to us. But look what it says about Paul in verse 15. When it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace. God knew Paul before he was even born. And God says about Paul, he was separated from his mother's womb. So that just goes to show you that God knows everything. And even though when Jesus was dying on the cross, he knew, look, I know the Jews are going to not accept me. And I know I'm going to have to take this to the Gentiles. And I know there's going to be a guy out in the future that I'm going to pick to give the gospel to take to the Gentiles and to preach. So God knows everything before it even happens. But it's interesting how God says in the Bible that he chose Paul and separated him from his mother's womb. There's another man in the Old Testament as well that says that. And that is Jeremiah. And Jeremiah tells us that he was separated from his mother's womb. One preacher said this, and it's kind of interesting, and it's a fun Bible study if you ever want to do it. But that one preacher one time says that everything that happens in the New Testament, all right, the New Testament is after Jesus died, there's always something to match it in the Old Testament. And he said, you can't go through the Bible without finding something happening in this Old Testament that happens almost exactly the same in the New Testament. It's almost like they mirror each other. Well, that's an interesting Bible study. I don't have time to go into that, but like, what are some examples? Well, here's an example. Back here in the Old Testament, there was a guy named Enoch. And the Bible says Enoch never died. It says he was translated. God took him alive straight up into heaven. Well, the Bible says in Hebrews that it's appointed a man once to die, but after this the judgment. But yet, Enoch never died. Back here in the Old Testament, there was one man that lived that never died. Who's that one guy? Well, is there a match in the New Testament? Well, yeah, before the tribulation, at the rapture, we who are saved, are alive and remain, shall be caught up with the Lord in the air. That means we're never going to die. So here at the rapture, there are some people, just like Enoch, were caught up to heaven without dying. He was caught up to heaven. So there are so many things like that that I could go through and show you. You have over here, Peter raises someone from the dead. Okay, so over here, Peter raises a dead guy. Well, back here, Elijah raises somebody from the dead. There's a match forward and back. So there's so many different things. It's a fun Bible study to do. No time whatsoever. I don't know why I even mentioned that. But it is interesting to see that back here we have a type of this, and up here a type of this. So we have back here Jeremiah, who is a type of Paul, separated from his mother's womb. And Jeremiah over here is a type of Paul. Jeremiah, as far as we know, never married. You know what's interesting? The Apostle Paul never married. So the type of Paul in the Old Testament is Jeremiah. So like I said, the cross, it's almost like there's a mirror, and every time something happened in the Old Testament, you could almost always find a match for it in the New Testament. Does that mean anything? I don't know. I just think it's interesting. It's quite interesting. So let's continue. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 15. But when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb. Interesting. From my mother's womb and called me by his grace. To reveal his son in me that I might preach him among the heathen. Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. Now look. He said to reveal his son in me. So verse 16 we have a revelation. And in verse 12 we have another revelation. So there are some things that God revealed. Verse 12, he says he was revealed the gospel, which is this. That's why I left it up here. In verse 16, he says to reveal his son in me. So God reveals his son in Paul. All right, what does that mean, to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among... Well, Paul was an example of long-suffering. Let's go over here to 1 Peter, I believe it is. And look what Paul says. This is interesting. And Paul says the following in 1 Peter chapter... I said 1 Peter. I'm in 1 Timothy chapter 1 in verse 16. All right, let's actually start in verse 12. Well, let's start in verse 11. Okay, 1 Timothy 1:11, and we'll start reading there on a little bit. So what we found in Galatians was that God chose Paul. He separated him from his mother's womb, revealed unto him the gospel, and he's also revealing in him his son, Jesus Christ. And the reason for that was so that he could preach to the heathen or the Gentiles. So in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 11, it says, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. Paul says, God committed unto me the gospel, to my trust, so I could go preach it to others. He says, and I thank God, Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for he hath counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer, and a persecutor, and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. Then he says, verse 15, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul looked at himself as the worst sinner that ever lived. Maybe he was. He said, I ignorantly in unbelief killed people. Well, he was religious. He was. Some people say, oh, he's religious. Religious people are great. Yeah, but they're murderers. But he said, I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And then look at verse 16. Howbeit, for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering, for a pattern to them which should after believe on him to life everlasting. So here we see Paul is a pattern of longsuffering. Now let's go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 15. Notice that he says that in me first, Jesus Christ might show forth something. And yet we saw earlier, he says that Jesus might reveal his son in me. So God is revealing through Paul, Jesus Christ. And Paul is an example of long suffering. So what did Peter say when he remembered Paul? Well, let's look at this. In 2 Peter 3:15, and account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. Even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. So look at that. The account that the long-suffering of our Lord. So Paul says that he is an example. Paul says, I'm an example of long-suffering. And then we come over here to Peter, and we read Peter saying that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, and he says, even as Paul. So Paul is connected with long-suffering. And he is a pattern of long-suffering for what? To show Jesus to others. To show grace. So let's put that together if we can. We looked at it last week that over here was Peter preaching. And people started to get saved into the body of Christ, into the church. And up shows this guy named Saul, who later his name was named Paul, who goes and starts killing people left and right that were friends of Peter's. And then later, God saves Paul. Now, let's look at this. See if I can get this together, get my thoughts together so I can explain this. Peter was preaching not grace and not the gospel, but preaching Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is the Messiah, get baptized in water to receive the Holy Spirit. That's what Peter was preaching. There was no message of grace yet. Acts 15:11, the church meets together and says, okay, we believe these Gentiles are saved by grace through faith, even as we. So, but we see that back here they were still preaching water baptism. Paul comes along and starts murdering people. And yet God chose to save Saul and name him Paul and use him to take the gospel. Do you see the pattern of long-suffering? God was long-suffering in that he didn't kill Paul for killing the early members of the church. I say that because in Acts chapter 5 there were two people, Ananias and a Sapphira, whatever her name is. Ananias and Sapphira, there, I said it right, they were killed by God because they supposedly sold everything and gave it to the early church. And when they came and said, did you do that? They lied because they kept some back and God killed them. Can you imagine what the early church was like? People were scared to death. If they lied or said something, God would kill them on the spot. Then shows up a guy named Saul and starts killing all of them and God doesn't kill him. God said, I separated him and chose him to be saved and to preach to other people. And God says he's a pattern of my long suffering. And it shows you how long-suffering Jesus was. From all the evil that people did, all throughout the ages, Jesus still allowed himself to die for those sins. So I hope I got that together where that makes sense. But what was Paul remembered for? Well, from the testimony of Peter, Paul was remembered as long-suffering. He was the example of long-suffering to the early church, how God was long-suffering enough to Paul to allow him to go kill people and do wrong. But even though he did it, God has suffered it for a purpose for him in the future to get saved and win people to the Lord. I hope that makes sense. So we come back to Galatians chapter 1 and verse 16. Paul says, to reveal his Son in me. Is the Son, is Jesus revealed in Paul? Yes, we see God's long-suffering to Paul by not killing him and by allowing him to continue on doing wrong because he knew in the future he'd save him. And that long-suffering of God towards Paul was grace. And what is the church age? It's an age of grace. So God showed grace to Paul. And as we look at Paul, we see Jesus. Because we say, wow, wow, Paul did evil. And yet he turned around and God used him for good. Jesus took our evil and our wickedness and our sins and he came out the better for it. So, I don't know, maybe that makes sense, maybe it doesn't. But I see through Paul the Son. And the other way we see the Son through Paul is because we see Jesus Christ here. And what is the gospel? It's a message of long-suffering. God was long-suffering in dying for our sins. I hope I got that together to where you can understand it. Paul was remembered as an example of God's grace. That's be the best way to say it. The early church, when they remembered Paul, when they saw Saul and they saw Paul, all they knew was, oh, that murderer, that murderer, that murderer. And then Paul shows up and says, hey, I got saved and I want to start preaching. And they're like, no, you're a murderer, you're a murderer, you're a murderer. And then he started preaching and all of a sudden the early church said, you know what, that's real. He really got saved. He really got converted. Look at God's grace. If God can save somebody that bad, wow. And so that's what Paul's an example of. Look how bad Paul is and look how good God was to save him. So we see the Son revealed through Paul that, hey, Jesus can save the worst of sinners. And Paul said, I was the chief of sinners. I was the worst there was. He said, God save me. So we see the Son. We see Jesus Christ through Paul because Paul was preaching Christ died for our sins. And when Paul preached Christ died for our sins, you know what the first thing people thought? Yeah, yours too, buddy. Because Paul was the guy that went around killing Christians. Then all of a sudden he shows up and says, man, I got saved and I'm sorry. This is how you get saved. What's a guy thinking? Yeah, you killed my mom. Yeah, Christ saves sinners. Yeah, I guess he does. If he saved you, you murderer. Can you imagine Paul preaching to the very same family members of the people that he before killed? So Paul is an example of long-suffering, of grace, of how good God is, that if he could save some evil murderer like Paul, then he could save us too. I hope that explained it. Okay, so back to to Galatians chapter 1, verse 16, to reveal his Son in me, that I may preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. So Paul says, God chose me before in my mother's womb to eventually go out and preach to the heathen. The heathen would be the Gentiles. But God also allowed Paul to go his own way and to end up being the Pharisee of Pharisees in a cult and kill people. And God knew, you know, he's going to do that. But I'm going to save him anyway because I have a purpose for him in the future. And it says, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. So after Paul got saved, the first thing he did was go somewhere. And he did not confer with flesh and blood. He didn't go ask for permission. He didn't go to man and say, well, now what do I do? He said, man, I'm saved. God saved me. Now I'm going to get alone for a little while. And he got alone, and he probably, in that time that he was alone, started reading the Bible. And started reading the Old Testament. What's so neat about the Old Testament books? All those Old Testament books talk about Jesus Christ. In type, or maybe in the case of prophecy, literally spoke of Jesus. You can't read Isaiah 53 without seeing it speaking of Jesus Christ. So all Paul would have done in that time after he got saved, when he got away from everybody, was he would have sat down and started reading the scriptures. And would have kept saying, wow, that talks about Jesus. Oh, wow, that talks about Jesus. Oh, wow. And you know, that's all they had in the Old Testament. I mean, right after Jesus died. In the New Testament, when they were getting saved in the church, All they had was the Old Testament scripture. So it is possible to lead someone to the Lord with the Old Testament. Because the Old Testament, now that it's been completed, we can see, oh, this was talking about Jesus. And that's what they were doing. I think that's so interesting because today, I don't go the Old Testament verses to try to win people to the Lord. I always take them 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. And, you know, take them to this verse, take them to that verse in the New Testament, in Romans, in 1 Corinthians. And yet, they didn't have that. So they were showing people Jesus Christ is the Messiah through the Old Testament books. That's amazing. That's amazing. I've heard several people today getting saved by reading Isaiah 53 and realizing, oh, that's Jesus Christ. So it is possible to get saved by reading Old Testament books, but it's always better to read the New Testament. So with that stated, he says, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went unto Arabia. Now, why did he go to Arabia? That's a desert. Well, that might be where he went to have his Bible school. He went and spent some time in the desert studying the Bible alone. And he told us that God revealed something to him, so that must be where God revealed it to him. So after he got saved, he got away from his religion. You see, when you get saved, if you're religious and you're in a false religion, you need to get out. You need to get out of that religion. He got away, and God began to reveal things to him. And it was through his reading of the Word. He says, and return again unto Damascus. And then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. Now, a lot of people say, then after 3 years means after Arabia. And they say that when Paul went, he went to Arabia for 3 years. I went to a Bible school that was a 3-year school. And they say, yeah, just like Paul was 3 years in Arabia, you're going to spend 3 years here at this Bible school and learn the Bible. It was a night school, 4 hours a night, every night, Monday through Thursday. It was fun. I enjoyed it. I praise God. One of the best Bible schools in the world. Probably the best. But it doesn't say here that he went 3 years to Arabia. It actually says that he went into Arabia, then returned to Damascus. And then he says, then after 3 years. So it looks like he was in Damascus for 3 years rather than Arabia. So it's hard to know. Some people think, well, he was Damascus. Well, let's actually turn to the book of Acts and find out. Now, where's my note? It's so tiny. I write so tiny in my notes in the Bible, but I have to have them all here. Let's look at when he's actually in Damascus and when this actually takes place in the book of Acts. Let's turn to Acts chapter 9 and verse 22. Acts 9, 22. See if we can figure this out. Was he 3 years in Damascus, or was he returned to Damascus and spent 3 years in Damascus and then went to Jerusalem? Acts chapter 3 and verse 22. But Saul increased the more in strength and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus. Now, this is after he got saved. And now he's going and he's preaching to people, proving that this is the very Christ. So what Paul was preaching was what the early apostles preached, that Jesus was the Messiah. He wasn't preaching that trust what Jesus did. He was saying, look, Jews, believe in who he is. That's why I'm dogmatic that the church started with the Jews preaching on who Jesus was, and then through Paul, the belief became what Jesus did for you. The who versus the what. I believe I got an old sermon entitled The Who Versus What of Salvation. Go to the past sermons there on thecloudchurch.org and see that. So he says that Paul, proving that this is the very Christ, and after that many days were fulfilled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. But their lying await was known to Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and let him down by the wall in a basket. When Saul was come to Jerusalem, he says, now when Saul, well, he's in Damascus. And it says, now, it says, and when Paul was come to Jerusalem. Now with that, let's look back at Galatians. It says, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia, returned again into Damascus, and then after 3 years I went to Jerusalem. So, either this verse is saying that he was in Arabia for 3 years, then went to Damascus, and then to Jerusalem, and it makes more sense this way. He said, I went into Arabia. We don't know how long he stayed in Arabia. But then I returned to Damascus, and it appears he was in Damascus for 3 years, and then he went to Jerusalem. So this is one of those verses that people kind of twist a little bit and take out of context because they want so bad to make him in Arabia for 3 years. And it's possible that he was. But looking in Acts, when it actually took place, it appears he was in Arabia for an unknown time. He returned to Damascus, where he stayed for 3 years, and during that time he was dealing with the Jews and telling them, hey, Jesus is the Messiah, he's the Christ. for 3 years, and they got so angry they tried to kill him. And then he went up to Jerusalem. Now, let's read this again, verse 17. Neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me. So right after he got saved, he didn't see any of the apostles. But I went into Arabia. So right after getting saved, he left, went to Arabia, and he studied in Arabia. Returned to Damascus. Well, after he returned from Damascus, he started preaching to Jews that Jesus was the Christ. We just read that in Acts. And returned again into Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him for 15 days. So after he had been preaching for at least 3 years, Paul said, now I'm going to visit Peter. So how long is this after when all this takes place? No idea. Let's see if I can figure this out. I'm not good with dates because it's very hard to figure out whether the dates in your Bible are true or not. But when we see Saul showing up in chapter 9. And see, this Bible says the date of chapter 9 is AD 35. Well, if Jesus died in AD 33, that only gives you 2 years to after when Paul starts to get saved. So if that date is true and we don't know, then you have to add 3 more years, so 5, 6, 7, 8. So about 38 AD to maybe 40 AD, somewhere around there, is where this passage says that Paul spoke with Peter. Well, that means that for a good 5 to 7 years, Peter and the early apostles had been preaching that Jesus is the Christ. And then God chose Paul, and Paul got together with Peter and said, hey, Peter, let's have a sit down, let's have a talk. Now, when Peter and Paul came together, this is what's so funny, Paul rebuked Peter. Look at verse 11 of chapter 2. Paul is speaking, and he says, but when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the faith, because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles, but when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which are of the circumcision. So Peter, who was the head of the church at that time, up shows another guy named Paul, who comes over and says, hey man, you're wrong. You're wrong. I'm going to have to stand up to you and withstand you to the face and rebuke you and tell you some things where you're wrong. And like I said earlier, isn't that crazy? Can you imagine being Peter and starting the church? And then this guy that's killing the church gets saved and then comes over and says, no, you're wrong. You would think Paul would never rise in the church as so high up as he did. But yet he is the one that God chose despite all odds. And he is the one that corrected Peter. And eventually Peter got straightened out because of Paul. And we will see that a little later. So, back to Galatians chapter 1. Looks like we'll be able to finish this chapter. Neither went up to Jerusalem, to them which were apostles before me, but I went to Arabia and returned again into Damascus. So from Damascus, then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem. So from Damascus to Jerusalem. And I went up to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. Now, can you imagine what they would have talked about? Wow, that must have been awesome. Let's see. I've got a reference here for 2 Corinthians 5:16. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 5:16. But I wonder what they would have talked about. I wonder if Peter wasn't a little intimidated and scared. the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:16, wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet henceforth know we him no more. This is about 60 AD. And Paul says, I don't know anybody else in the flesh except Jesus. So I wonder if Peter had moved away or died or something, but I don't know if that had anything to do with this passage or not, just a Bible note that I had in my margin. But Paul spent 2 weeks with Simon Peter, and imagine the questions he must have asked. Imagine what they would have talked about. I mean, I wish that I had a time machine, and I wish I could say, Mr. Peabody, let's go back to, you know, however long ago that was it 35 or 38 or 40 AD, whenever, and let's sit down and just listen in that almost 2 week period, those 14 days or 15 days, what did Peter and Paul speak about? That must have been amazing. Now he says, but other of the apostles saw I none save James, the Lord's brother. Now we will come back to that. Let me comment it on it now. Verse 19. Other of the apostles saw I none save James, the Lord's brother. You know what that verse right there does? Look at this. Make sure I've got room to write this up here. Your church in Rome that claims to be the Roman Catholic Church believes that salvation, or excuse me, that their church is right, and they say that Jesus is here, and Jesus is the Redeemer, and then that church says Mary is sinless, and she is the co-Redeemer. A redeemerix, I don't even know how they say it, co-mediatrix or something. They have funny terms. But that Catholic Church tries to tell you that Mary was sinless and that Mary was a perpetual virgin. And the Catholic Church says that Mary never ever had any other children except Jesus Christ. Is that true? Because if that Church of Rome, the Roman Catholic Church, is wrong on one thing, couldn't they be wrong on others? Was Mary a perpetual virgin, or did she have children after Jesus Christ? That's the question. Let's go to Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6 and verse 3. This is important because the Catholic Church tells us that Mary is a virgin today. She was a virgin before she had Jesus. Certainly that is correct. The Father of Jesus Christ was God the Father, the Holy Spirit. But after she had Jesus, she had other kids. And we just saw in Galatians, James, the Lord's brother. James was the stepbrother of Jesus Christ because Joseph and Mary had more children. That means Mary was not a perpetual virgin. Now, Mark chapter 6 and verse 3. Look at this verse. They're speaking and they say, is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary? Okay, the Jews are asking about Jesus. Is Jesus not the carpenter, the son of Mary? Okay, so Mary is Jesus' mother. The brother of James? Well, Galatians just said the brother of James, the Lord's brother, and it says, and of Judah, and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us? The passage of Scripture right here is telling us that Mary had, at the very least, six other children. Because it says the brother of James, Joseph, Judah, and Simon, that's four brothers, and his sisters. So there must be at least two sisters. So that means five, six, and then you include seven, that Jesus, that makes seven. Mary had at least seven children. At least. When it says his sisters, means there could have been one more or two more. It could have been 10, 20 kids. They had lots of children back there. But according to the Bible, Mary was not a perpetual virgin. That is to say, Mary, yes, was a virgin when she gave birth to Jesus Christ. But she was not a perpetual virgin. So that means every time a Roman Catholic calls Mary the virgin, it's a lie. She was a virgin before Jesus, but to call her the virgin is to lie, because she is no longer a virgin. She did marry Joseph. It actually says about Joseph, and he knew her not until she brought forth her firstborn child. After that, he knew her and had other children, and that was the names and mentions who they are. So there are many other verses about this. Let's look at, let's go ahead and look at 1 Corinthians 15, 5 through 7. I don't know how people could follow the Catholic Church when they are so messed up on so many things. And for them to dogmatically declare, oh yeah, Mary is a perpetual virgin. She never had sex in all of her life. And yet the Bible says she had at least 600 other kids after Jesus Christ. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 5 through 7. We just read the gospel in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, last time. And verse 5 says, and that he was seen of Cephas, now Cephas is another name for Simon Peter, then of the 12. And after that he was seen of about 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. After that he was seen of James, then all of the apostles. And then at last he was seen of me also, of one born out of due time. So, why does it mention James first and then say all the apostles? For that, we're going to have to go to the book of Acts and look at chapter 15. Acts chapter 15. Because in the early church, we find, this is so crazy, there's so many people that don't read the Bible. The Roman Catholic Church says Peter was the first pope. Is that true? Is that right? No. There are no popes in the Bible. They want to make Peter the religious leader of the early church. We're going to find out that the early leader was James, the brother of Jesus Christ. You say, what? How's that? Let's go to Acts chapter 15. In Acts chapter 15, it says, "And certain men came down from Judea, taught the brethren, and said, except you be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you cannot be saved." That's what we're dealing with, or we're going to get to, in the book of Galatians. These people came in trying to say, you must keep the law to be saved. Okay, so, "When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question." So, Paul was disputing with these people who said, you've got to keep the law of Moses. And Paul was saying, no, you have to preach grace through faith alone and not of works. And there was a huge dissension and disputation. And so the church said, okay, let's all meet together in Jerusalem and talk about this. This, I guess you could call the first concilial, or whatever you call it, council of the early church. And so they were brought, and being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. Who was declaring that? Paul. Hey, there were Gentiles saved. So they came together. And then, verse 4, "When they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. And there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to be commanded them to keep the law of Moses. And the apostles and elders came together for to consider this matter." So this is the first great council of the church coming together to agree, okay, do we keep the law of Moses, or is it by grace through faith alone? So verse 7, "When there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto him, Men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe." Now listen to this. Peter's the first one to open his mouth. You read through the apostles, who's the first one that's always opened his mouth? Peter. So Peter's the first one to stand up and say something. "And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now, therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ we shall be saved, even as they." And then it says, "Then all the multitude kept silence, and gave audience to Barnabas and Saul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. And after they had held their peace," listen to this, "James answered, saying, Men and brethren, hearken unto me." So who was the one that closed the council? It was James. And it appears that in the Bible, James was the leader of the church of Jerusalem. And so Peter stood up first and started talking. Now it was all over. James says, okay, this is what we're going to do. So it seems like James was the head of the church back then. "Simeon hath declared how God at first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name." And on and on and on it talks about it. So it appears like the head of the church was James, the Lord's brother. All right, so what it appears is that the leader of the early church was most likely James, who was the Lord's brother. Now, Peter could have been. Maybe they voted and took turns. But Peter and James are surely mentioned as the head or the pillars. And we remember Peter, James, and John are called the pillars of the church. So here's James, the Lord's brother, but it almost looks like, according to Acts 15, that he was the head of the church. So now we go back to... So let's go back to our chapter and finish this out. "But other of the apostles saw I none, save James, the Lord's brother." We know that the Lord had a brother named James, which means Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, Mary. But Mary married Joseph after and had at least six other children. So Mary is not a perpetual virgin. And then in verse 19, "But other of the apostles saw I none, save James, the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God, I lie not." Paul is telling us, I am not lying, I'm telling you the absolute truth. Verse 21, "Afterwards I came into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ." Notice how important that was. Last time we looked at the body of Christ, and how the body of Christ is the church. To be in the body is to be in Christ, and to be in Christ is to be in the body of Christ. So here Paul says, the bodies of Christ, or the churches of Christ in Judea. Judea is where the Jews are. That's back here. So the church started with Jews, and these Jews were in Christ. And then Paul went to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles became fellow heirs of the body of Christ. And then we go to verse 23, "But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preacheth the faith which he once destroyed, and they glorified God in me. And we'll close there in Galatians chapter 1. We've gone through the entire first chapter. Next time we can start in chapter 2. But all they knew was this guy named Saul, or Paul, got saved. He used to persecute the church, but now he's preaching the faith. So what a blessing to see how God used Paul, and he was able to take to them the faith of salvation. So that's Galatians chapter 1. We haven't even scratched the surface. There's so much more that we're about to see as we get into chapter 2. And we looked a little bit about it as we read Acts chapter 15, about how certain came in and said, yeah, you're saved by grace through faith. Yeah, whatever. You got to keep the law. You got to be circumcised. And so they were preaching a faith plus works. And the early church met and said, no, it's not faith and works. It's grace through faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we will see what the Bible says about those people that are preaching another gospel. And what is the other gospel? Well, it's a perverted gospel. And that's how you pervert the gospel. It's mixing works in and trying to say, yeah, it's great Jesus did that, but we've got to do something as well. No, it's either the work of Christ that saves us, or it's our own work. It's one or the other. It can't be both. And according to the Bible, you're saved by grace through faith and not of works, lest any man should boast. So thanks for watching. I'm looking forward to next time. Hope we can get a long ways through. This is just such an amazing book, and it's so important to understand the book of Galatians, as it helps us get straight salvation. It's by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. So thanks. Have a good one. We'll see you next time.